The first one is called former self-defense. One summer evening, years ago, when I was a nice College Mount high school senior, my girlfriend and I were wandering around the sidewalks of a closed shopping center along with some other nice College Mount seniors. But there were also some bad kids there, the kids who were headed for lives of petty crime and repeated misdemeanor citations before finally giving in and becoming policemen. We were on foot. They were driving around slowly in an old Chevy. Thus, you could tell us apart. The Chevy pulled up next to me. The driver rolled down his window. "Hey," he yelled, "you guys have any drugs?" Like the Terminator, I possess an interior view screen that displays various potential replies to such challenges. I selected smartass mode and replied, "If I had any drugs, would I be walking around out here?" "What did you say?" There might have been an abort option flashing on my view screen, but I ignored it. I said, "If I had any drugs, would I be..." The doors of the car flew open, and four large young men flew out of the car. Apparently, the ancient Talmudic technique of answering a question with a question was deeply offensive to them. Jewish nerds? The driver came straight at me, his face contorted with anger, his mullet undulating. He grabbed me by the collar of my sweatshirt and pushed me back against the plate glass window of a knick-knack store. "What did you say?" I began doing what I did best during those days of my wild youth. I apologized. I apologized for any offense, actual, imagined, intended, or otherwise. I described my remorse from various angles in the way you would describe a Frank Gehry building to a blind man. My girlfriend, who was now about 20 yards ahead of me down the sidewalk, called out irritated, "Come on, Peter!" As if I had inconvenienced her by choosing to chat with a group of passers-by while one of them massaged my Adam's apple with his knuckles. "You're right there," I said, and continued to apologize. My hands were up by my ears. To make sure this was seen as a gesture of surrender rather than aggression, I wiggled my fingers out. There must be some kind of code among suburban narrative wells dictating that you can't beat up somebody who is so willing to abase himself. So the leader released his grip on my nascent waffle. I slid a bit down the glass. As they turned and walked back to their car, they seemed deflated. Then one of them stopped, turned again, and kicked the air right in front of my face, a martial arts move of some kind, either a warning as to what I had just avoided or an attempt at a dominant animal crotch display. I caught up with my friends and nobody said a word. In fact, I don't think anybody said anything to anyone else about anything until we all broke up with one another and went to college. A decade later, I was studying Aikido, a Japanese martial art known for its flowing movements and its strong attraction for bookish dorks. Suffice it to say that in every dojo I have ever been in, and this is true, somebody has laughingly tried out the Vulcan nerve pinch on somebody else. Aikido appeals to nonviolent types because in its classic form it is entirely defensive. All of its maneuvers are responses to attacks. If two Aikido masters were to fight, they would stand staring at each other in perfect readiness, waiting for somebody to do something, until the night janitor came by and made them leave. One afternoon in the dojo, I found myself thinking about that long ago evening at the shopping center, as I had about every 15 minutes since the incident. I asked the instructor if there was a proper technique for defending yourself against an attacker who had you by the throat and was holding you up against a knick-knack shop. "Let's try it," he said. The class broke up into small groups, with some people unknowingly replicating me, the others taking on the role of my attackers. The instructor demonstrated a simple yet powerful defensive move. I tried it, and my attacker collapsed in pain. "Or you could do this," said the instructor, and I was happily hurling my training partners onto the mat, twisting their arms in such a way that somewhere back in New Jersey, grown men who had completely forgotten me and long ago sold that car felt a twinge in their shoulders. "What about," I asked, "if someone tries to kick you in the face?" "Oh, that's easy," said the instructor. "Just grab and twist." An obliging partner offered to kick me in the face. "No," I said, "do it sideways, like a karate kick." He adjusted. I grabbed and twisted, and he fell to the mat with a gratifying oomph of ejected air. "Do it again," I said. "Again!" I felt at peace. I realized that now all I had to do was track down my long-lost girlfriend, who I believe is living in Texas with her husband. Then I would wait for someone to drive by in a Camaro. I would know just what to do. Thank you. Okay. Are that okay?